Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. My name is Beth Mars. I'm the director of the annual fund here at Stewart Pinchot Gage School. And it's my pleasure to introduce Rekia Reynolds, president and founder of Sky Blue Media. And this workshop is called Man of Your Brain. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Hello.
Hi. So I'm probably not going to stand back here. I'd like to get up close and personal, so I'm going to stand up here and talk to you guys. Is it okay if I don't use the microphone?
Yes.
Okay, good. And I apologize in advance. I have still a little tickle. I came back from vacation and had a sinus infection and bronchitis all in the same city. So needless to say, it has not been a fun week for me, and I typically don't get sick. Like, I take care of myself. I told the doctor, I said, I wash my hands all the time, I drink plenty of water, I exercise, and he said, well, you do not live in a bubble.
Yeah.
So you are prone to get sick, and he also said, as we mature, I like that he said, as we mature, sometimes, you know, those illnesses come back. So I like the word mature. So just wanted to give you guys just a quick overview of Fan of Your Brand. So I started doing these talks called Fan of Your Brand, and I spent a lot of time around young people, and I kept saying, these young people are getting lost in life. Like, you go, you're on social media, and you sort of fall down a black hole. You're concentrating so much on someone else's profile and someone else's photo, and I do a ton in the branding space, and I said, well, why can't people be a fan of their own brand? So how do we teach people to be a fan of their brand? So just to give you a little bit of the story behind my glory, I have a company called Sky Blue Media. I typically wear lots and lots of blue, and I tell people that when I ran out of wearing blue things, I started to color my hair blue. When I couldn't find any more blue nail polish or blue skirts or blue shoes, it was my assistant at the time said, well, why don't you just dye your hair blue? And I was like, wow, that's a thought. I'll dye my hair blue. It has to be color pleasing, so it's looking a little Eagles green, go Eagles. Years ago, I was a television producer for MTV, TLC, and Discovery Health. And I was also writing teases. So I was a script writer. So when you hear those things on the next episode of Surviving Motherhood, or stay tuned to see Beth and her friends. So I was script writing, and I was a turning producer, and I was a line producer. I did a ton in the world of producing. And in between television shows, when I got bored, in television, there's a dark period where you go on hiatus and things go dark and the producers are playing. I never really went dark. It was, what else can I do? So I started producing fashion editorials for Lucky Magazine. So I was producing all of the concepts and figuring out why the spread should look the way that they did. So it was using a lot of my right side of my brain. So being the true creative that I was. And I like to tell people the context behind this because in getting into becoming a television producer, I always say I became a television producer in the fourth grade. So when I was in the fourth grade, I was diagnosed with ADHD, and my father kept saying, to my teachers, what can we do to get her to sit still in class? How do we get her to learn like all the other kids? And I'll never forget, 2 years after that, sixth grade, Ms. Arnfola was one of my teachers, and she said, well, she's not going to learn like all of the kids in class. She's not going to write things down on paper like all of the other kids. Why don't we figure out something else for Rekia? So my dad had just gotten a video camera, and I remember I had to do this big book report on the Boston Tea Party. And I was like, wow, this, and the teacher said it had to be an 8-page report. I was like, an 8-page report? Like, that's daunting. How am I going to do an 8-page report? And so my dad said, well, why don't you videotape everything that you want to say? Why don't you videotape all of the messages that you want to communicate and get across? Bring your friends over. This could be a group project. And that's what I did. So I wrote, instead of handing in a book report like all of the other kids, I rolled down the television down into the classroom with a VHS tape, and I was able to play my report. So, you know, going to college, I had to study a little differently. I had to apply myself a little differently. And when I graduated from college, I actually landed a job in higher education, working at Temple University. And then someone from MTV found me. They called and said, hey, we heard that you're this creative living in Philadelphia. We're trying to produce a teen drama series with the folks from Degrassi High and My So-Called Life. You guys know him as Drake. His name was Aubrey. Back in the day when we were producing with him. But it was being able to work with all of the script writers to communicate what these messages should be like on television. And then when I started working in television and, you know, working in magazines, I said, you know, there's a different path for me. And I decided to start a multimedia communications agency. So taking all of the things that I'd learned at MTV and TLC and Discovery Health and Lucky Magazine, and I still wanted to tell stories. I still wanted to communicate these messages, but it wasn't for MTV and TLC and Discovery Health. At that time, it was, how do I work with entrepreneurs and people that have businesses that can't communicate? How can I communicate on their behalf? So I essentially became the spokesperson for people. And that ended up being lots of great people that I never, ever anticipated. So the first 3 years of my business, I was working diligently to build a brand, to build something that I didn't have to go out and pitch myself. I wanted to build something so that people could call me and find me and say, hey, we heard what you did with this person. We heard what you did with that person. How can you do the same thing that you did for those people and do them for us? So my first big client actually was Uber. And they came to me and said, hey, we heard that you're sort of this kooky producer and you communicate a little differently. We want to work with someone to communicate our message of this on-demand car app, but we want something a little differently. We don't want a regular, traditional public relations agency. We want something a little differently. And I was communicating. I, you know, told you guys that I used to communicate using videos. So when I started my multimedia communications agency, I wasn't sending out press releases because that's not how I learned when I grew up. I was always using videos. So people said, this is a woman who's using content and videos to communicate a message. So Uber brought me on to craft out all of the communications plans for what they were doing in Philadelphia, what they were doing in New York City, what they were doing in San Francisco. After I started working with Uber and creating all of these comprehensive communication plans and telling them how they should communicate to their target audience, I then got a call from Dell and I started working with Dell. I'm now the face of small business for Dell and I'm in their commercials and billboards. And again, how do you communicate a little differently? So I used all of the things that I've done as a kid. You know, when my teachers were saying, she interrupts classroom, she sings out loud, she can't sit in her seat, she doesn't communicate like all of the other kids. So I went from being an interrupter to being a disruptor. It really disrupted the way that people did public relations. So it's always looking at what are those things that are your weaknesses or the things that people say are the negative attributes. So sometimes people will say, these are your negative attributes, and then how do you turn them into a positive? And then I started working with Serena Williams, and Serena Williams, her manager saw me on television, and it was simply, hey, we hear you talking about social media and digital media, and you use your hands a lot, and we like the way that you communicate. How can you do what you did for Dell and what you did for Uber? Can you do the same thing for Serena Williams? So I started working with Serena Williams on her fashion brand for HSN. And quite recently, I started working with the city of Philadelphia to build out their creative proposal when Amazon, HQ2, when Amazon started looking for a new headquarters, they put out a bid to 263 cities, and all of the cities started to compete. And so the city of Philadelphia hired me and they said, we have all these papers that we're putting together. We've hired this big research company called McKinsey and they've given us all of the facts and the figures. Can you work with McKinsey and create a creative side of the proposal? We want something visual. We want something that's going to stand out to Amazon. And so I worked with web developers and interactive map makers and video producers to create a story on why Philadelphia should be considered for the next HQ2, which then got us into the top 20 spots. And now I'm under NDA, but we did look at the website. we use the angles and why we use some of the language that we use. So how many of you, so we're going to talk, that goes into to brand. How many of you can talk to me about what you think it is that a brand is? One, just one person, just tell me what your sort of definition of a brand is.
The name of a company?
Yes.
Reputation. Mm-hmm. As the face of a
Absolutely. So a brand, in the dictionary terms, it's the symbol, it's the identity, it's how you identify a person or a product. So you can look at Nike and know that it's Nike without having to read the letters N-I-K-E, because what do you remember about Nike?
Swoosh.
The swoosh brand. And exactly. It's the swoosh. So sometimes we can communicate without having to use words or letters. And your personal brand, so you know, when we look at, so Cycle Media, our commercial is that we work with people and products on their business, branding, and bragging. So when we work with people, we talk to them about their personal brand. When we work with products, we talk to them about their logo, what colors they are using, what is their identity, what is your brand manifesto, what is your promise to a consumer. And essentially, that's the same thing that you're doing when you're talking about your personal brand. So your personal brand is not that far off from the definition of a product. Your personal brand is your manifesto. That is your mark. That is your calling card. And more that we get ingrained in technology, the less and less we're going to be using things like bios and resumes or curriculum vitae, is what we like to call it in the fancy way. So your brand, your footprint, your digital footprint is essentially your reputation when you're not in the room. So in working at Cyber Media, and I started Cyber Media in 2009, and again, having worked with all of these amazing companies, this is sort of what we've broken down as the six building blocks of being a fan of your brand. So there's the verbal piece, and I'll get into all of these, but the verbal piece is, what are people saying about you when you're not in a room? How do people introduce you? And what is the perception and that footprint and that stamp that you leave on people verbally? There's the nonverbal piece. So the nonverbal piece is really a combination of things. It's the images, it's the photos, it's the colors that you're using. So you see that I talked about blue. When I started Sky Blue Media, so shout out to my daughter right here, one of my daughters, her name is Sky. Mm-hmm. And then Joey.
Can we take pictures?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Sorry.
So her name is Sky. And when she was born, my husband and I were trying to figure out a name for her. And one of my friends happened to be the creative director at Nike in Japan at the time. And he said, I've fallen in love with this beautiful girl, and her name is I. He's spelled it AI. And he said, but the action of love is SKAI. And he said, we'll name our daughter SKAI. And when I was trying to figure out the name for my company, Sky kept coming about, and what I did was I surveyed all of the people that I worked with at MTV and TLC and Discovery Health, and I said, what are the words that you use to describe me when I'm not in the room? How do you perceive me when I'm not sitting next to you? What is the value that I brought in working with you at your company? And one executive producer said, you always create a sky blue picture for us. Everything is really clear when we sit in a room or we have a script and you are able to help us to dissect it. So then I started doing more research in sky blue. Okay, so we have sky and then we have blue. So what does the color blue mean? So big companies will tell you they have a data analyst and they have a color. They do all of this research around color intelligence. You can Google a color wheel. You Google a color wheel or the meaning of colors, a wheel will come up. And that's why I really love the Lead Like a Girl logo, because the Lead Like a Girl logo shows you all of the complexities of creativity. So the color blue is the color of trust, honesty, and sincerity. And when I started a company, I said, I want to build a company on trust. I don't want to be a traditional communications agency, because all the other publicists that I knew were massaging copy. So it's essentially, they weren't telling the truth. And I said, well, how can I disrupt this model? I want to always tell the truth. And if I'm painting a sky blue picture for Like a Girl logo, if you look at your bag, there's pinks in there, there are blue hues in there. So pink is also a color for creativity. There's some hues of orange in there. Orange means growth and vitality. So then you look at purple, and purple is the color that's used for being royal or regal with women. So they're really true to the brand and the definition of creativity and the complexities of what goes into color intelligence. Then we look at the other block, which is written. What are the words that you put on paper to describe who you are, how you do it, where you do it, and when you do it? So when you're looking at what your brand is, people always say you answer the questions who, what, when, where, and why. Why is the most important when you come to looking at what your personal brand is, because the why is your unique value proposition. It's your human interest perspective. It's what sets you apart from the crowd. And then we look at social and digital, and that's probably for a lot of the younger people, and that social and that digital footprint is, what are your captions that you're using on Instagram? What comes up when people Google you or look at their sort of SEO sort of footprint, when they Google you, sometimes your Twitter feed comes up because Twitter has a very high search engine optimization. So it's very important to look at what is the photo that you may be using on Twitter. If your profile is public on Instagram, then that optimizes as well, and that will come up. But what are the words that you're using? That can be for your bio, that can be for your resume, that can be in your Twitter bio, so it doesn't necessarily have to be the biography that you give out, and you're speaking at a conference and someone says, what's your long-form bio and your short-form bio? But your bio now is just two sentences that is your digital footprint online. And then networking. It's always important when you're networking in the room, when you're, people say you work a room, what is your elevator pitch? Because one of my favorite authors, and you guys should take a look at his book, his name is Adam Grant, he has a book called Give and Take. And he talks about us living in a society where we give and take. So you want to walk into a room, you want to give someone something, but you also want to take it. You want to have a call to action. I'm giving myself to you, I'm telling you who I am, what I do, when I do it, where I do it, why I do it, and my call to action might be, how can we do something together? How may we meet for coffee? Or how can we spend some time together because we might be building or we might be partnering on something. So we live in a society where it is very give and take. And then, for those people that are a little further along in building their brand, we talk a lot about media presence. So media presence is what are the opinion pieces you might be writing online. Or I saw a reporter out here interviewing some of the speakers. So their quotes will live in The Patch or the Princeton Packet or another publication, and that will increase their media presence online. Because people will read about them online. They'll also, have that hard copy piece where it increases their media presence. So, a little bit about when I was talking to you about my brand and personal brand, there are simple worksheets that you can do to ask, what is your personal brand? People always ask me, well, Rakia, what is the first step in building my personal brand? How do I know who I am, what I do, when I do it, where I do it, and why I do it? And you can develop your own. So my chief of staff came up with this term called friend tours. And I like friend tours because friend tours are the friends and mentors that you have in the room with you, and they're also the advocates that are in the room when you are not in the room. And they're the people that are your ambassadors, your influencers, that can help to describe you. So you want to assemble a friend tour advisory board. And a friend tour advisory board can be 2 to 8 people that are people that are close to you, people that you have some sort of relationship with. It could be a family member, it could be a coworker, it could be your yoga partner, it could be your running mate. But you want to get that friend tour advisory board together. And you ask them those questions. You ask them simple things. What do you think about me? Why do you jog with me? Why do we go yoga? Why do we go to yoga together? Why do you like my banana pudding? Why do you chuckle when I speak? And if you ask people, you'd be surprised. People will give you the answers that you might be looking for. They might say, you inspire me. You motivate me. You encourage me. You make me laugh. I think you're really creative. I think that you're really intelligent. And you take all of those words, we call them words. I? What do I do? Why do I do it? When do I do it? And then if you want to get a little more granular, you put in the where's and the how's. But that elevator commercial is something that sticks for you when you are using something for your online presence, when you're in a room networking, when you are trying to increase your media presence. If a reporter came up to you right now and said, hey, I'd like to interview you because you're here at the Lead Like a Girl conference, we want to get your thoughts, we want to get your opinion, we want to know what you think about the Lead Like a Girl conference. You don't want to just say, well, I thought the Lead Like a Girl conference was great. You want to say, my name, why you're here, what's your position in the marketplace, why are you here? I'm someone that's out here trying to network, or I wanted to have a day, you know, being inspired because I'm someone that is starting a writing career. You want to give someone your position and then give them your thoughts. We like to call them, you know, those op-ed pieces, those opinion education pieces. Well, op-ed pieces don't just live online. They're not things that you just write down. Those op-ed pieces are pieces that stay with you when you're also talking to someone. So this is my word cloud here. And my word cloud was essentially easy things for me. I'm an entrepreneur, I'm a creative, I'm a leader, I'm a daughter, friend, wife, I think I'm passionate, I think I'm talented, I'm ambitious, I'm a woman, and I'm the founder and CEO of a company. So I use those words when people are asking me, God bless you, when people are asking me about myself or asking me why I do what I do. So I'm gonna get a little more into that verbal and that nonverbal and the written. And I wanted to stop. Let me just make sure if the how are we on time? Okay, I was actually going to stop at 1:20 because what I want to do is spend time with you so that you can ask me specific questions. Typically, how I work with clients, I do a ton in strategy sessions, and I have 3-hour strategy sessions. I just had a big strategy session with Morgan Stanley of all companies, and they brought me into a room and said, what do you think about our brand? And we dissected the colors, and we talked about their competitive advantage in the marketplace. And I want you to be able to ask those questions as well. So I'm starting to get back to my roots. When I started the company, I was working with individuals and entrepreneurs. And then overnight, I started working with all these big corporate companies. But my favorite is working with entrepreneurs and solopreneurs and people that are, you know, running things at an extra. So in the verbal setting, it's always important to practice those words. And I'll talk a little bit about one of my clients later. When you are looking at the verbal piece, if you want someone to say something about you, it has to sound good coming out of your mouth first. And it's sometimes a little kooky for you to be in the mirror. My kids will tell you, I used to make them go into a mirror every morning and say, I am bold, beautiful, and brilliant. Well, I wanted everybody else to believe that my children were bold, beautiful, and brilliant. But no one would believe that my children were bold, beautiful, and brilliant if they weren't saying that in the mirror to themselves and saying those affirmations on a daily basis. And if you say it to yourself, you can convince yourself that you are bold, beautiful, and brilliant. That nonverbal piece is really important. In the day and age that we live in, everything is online. Someone found out my home address, which I was really surprised at, because they saw me in a Dell commercial and they wrote me a letter. Yeah, I'll tell you that later. And they found out my home, but everything is online. And for some of us, it is really important to have a well-crafted online presence. And believe it or not, for students, I know a ton of people in admissions. I was sitting with someone that selects a lot of the Harvard students, and she sat with me and brought me through all of their online profiles and said, what do you think about them? Now, these are students that spent months, years, maybe their entire lives prepping for this proposal and pitch and application to Harvard, but the selection committee will bring me to a cafe and have me look at their online profile. And some of the photos that have come up can really hurt them. And there was one photo of one student, which I felt horrible. And I knew the photo was a joke. She had taken a photo with the cigarette sort of hanging out of her mouth, and it looked like a surveillance photo. And it was a joke. But when I started going through the profiles, I had to be honest with the folks from Harvard. I couldn't say, well, I know this is a joke. I only see what I saw online. So I had to say, well, her online perception shows that she may not be as serious as she's telling you that she is on this application. So you have to know, and people say this all of the time, that the internet is not written in pencil. It is written in ink. You can erase it, but someone has already taken a snapshot of it. You can put it on your Instagram story, and yes, it disappears after 24 hours, but guess what? Someone else has taken a screenshot of it and put it in their digital catalog and put it into their digital file cabinet to file it on you. So just know that your digital footprint is superseding everything that you're saying online. So that nonverbal piece is going to speak volumes for you. That is what is going to be your mouthpiece when you're not in the room. And then the written piece used to be the biggest piece. But, and I used to say the written piece was the main course, and then the nonverbal piece was were the vitamins. And now it's completely reversed right now. The written piece is your supplemental value. It's what your story architect is. It's you being the narrator of your own life and your own destiny online. So choose your words wisely. And then that just goes into that social and digital footprint that I talked about and the networking piece, because I think that we often forget that, you know, we're spending all of this time online building our social and digital footprint, but we are still a human species that likes human interaction. We like to sit with one another. We like to talk to one another. When you go into a room, and sometimes networking is not just a room full of people. Networking can be you and someone else one-on-one. And you have to practice those words. You have to affirm the written piece that you put online. You have to affirm what that nonverbal piece is, and the networking piece is a culmination of all of that. And then the media presence, which we talked about, and I'm going to speak at length here because I don't know how many of you are trying to do media piece. So I just wanted to talk to you guys a little bit about Ashley Graham. So Ashley Graham has been our client for the past 4 years, and she came to me. I was speaking on a panel maybe 4 years ago talking about the importance of personal brand, and she said, well, I was just kicked out of the Ford modeling agency because, you know, I'm a curvy woman and I want to be the next top model. I don't want to be a plus size top model, but I want to be the next top model. And we spent 6 months looking at what her verbal presence was, what her written presence was, what that social and digital was, what was she saying in a room. And I found out when I was sitting with her that she was saying to people, I'm a plus size woman. And I said, well, you're telling people when you go into a room that you're a plus size woman, that's the only language that they've been equipped to sort of explain you with. And if you're online and you're using on your Instagram that you're a plus size model, people are going to explain you as a plus size model. So we had to really disrupt the language that she was using online and in person and create a comprehensive communications plan. And that plan, we started using special hashtags like beauty beyond size. That doesn't say I'm a plus size woman or I'm a curvy woman. It just says that I believe that there is beauty beyond size. And when you're looking at that written piece and you're looking at the nonverbal piece, it's always important to remember what your mission is, what is it that you believe in that accompanies that who, what, when, where, and why. And then, most importantly, what is the vision? Where do you want to go? Because you can speak about where you want to go and put in the present tense, again, with the present tense, and it also shows the purpose behind your brand. So when you're looking at creating all of your components of your personal brand, it's really, really important, as I said, what your mission, your vision, and your purpose is. And then the last thing that I wanted to say is, you know, one of the things that we got to work, you know, in addition to Ashley, our youngest client is a 13-year-old social activist who came to us when she was 9 years old, and her entire story, she said, I want to start a movement. I really want to disrupt the literary space. In my library, all I read about is Old Yeller, and I'm tired of reading about white boys and their dogs. That was her entire thing. She said, Ms. Rakia, I'm tired of reading about white boys and their dogs. What can we do? And her mother and I, we essentially said to her, what do you want to do about it? And we created a campaign called #1000BlackGirlBooks, where Marley Dyess set out to find 1,000 books with brown and black girls comparable, and we did a lot with Marley, similar to what I did. We had her wear green glasses. We had her wear two braids, so people always knew the distinction between Marley and any other child that came across the screen. So we used the colors green to represent growth, that this was a girl that had a growing mind. She had a lot of ideas. And so she wore those green glasses for about 2 years until the campaign completely kicked off. And we used #1000BlackGirlVotes because we knew that her generation was communicating through hashtags. They weren't going to be writing things down, but they were going to be searching her using hashtags. And then when you go back to, the written piece, it was an entire commercial of what we wrote about in terms of her mission, her vision, and her purpose. Who she was, why she was doing it, where she was doing it, and what her unique value proposition was. So I wanted to stop here to say, don't get lost in likes. I want you all to be a fan of your own brand. And I just wanted to open it up for any questions.
You know what? It's
think, you know, we had him on Good Morning America. How did you think that I did? I said, well, Ashley, you used words that you didn't know the definition. So I don't ever want you getting on air using descriptive words unless you know the definition of that word. Because what people will start to do is look at you to say, she's a model. She's pretty. She's not intelligent. And we don't ever want people to perceive you that way. So we started to train her. We got her coaches, and I hired a media coach for her. And I got her a tutor. I said, I want her to study because I want people to know that she is an intelligent businesswoman. Now, initially, those were really uncomfortable conversations. But when you work in the branding and communication space, you always have to be prepared to have uncomfortable conversations. And it's not about, you know, keeping it nice. It's laying the foundation to tell people all of the time, hey, I'm doing this for your own good, sort of like when you talk to your kid, listen, this is not her me, woman hurts you, but I have to tell you the truth. And so we just keep it, we always say we keep it 100, like we keep it 100 and we're always honest.
Yeah. At what time do you feel one part of the brand they've created for themselves or a company, and then feel this is the point where you pause, reflect, and reinvent? So, I'm assuming, my question is, do you set the outcome for your brand, or what your brand needs to accomplish prior to, and once, when do you feel that milestone needs to stop, when it's not hitting that milestone, and then be one?
See, I don't think that I think people stop evaluating their brand and working on their brand when they get comfortable. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that anyone should ever be comfortable, because we live in such a fast-paced, technological world that someone is always hitting the refresh button. And you should constantly hit the refresh button. You should be evaluating your brand at least once a year. You should be surveying your audience to say, why are you following us? Why do you purchase goods or services from us? Why are you here? And a lot of people stop asking those questions because they essentially get really comfortable. And the big companies do it all of the time. I'm sitting there and it's like, why have you had the same typography and the same font for the past 25 years? And they always say, well, it's not broke, don't fix it. Well, no, we live in a society where, you know, Fortune 500 companies spend so much time getting to where they are, and now you have tech startups taking 4 years to get to the same spot that these other companies are. So if you want to be in a lane where you're just complacent, then by any means, don't refresh your brand. Don't evaluate the brand. Don't second guess the brand. But if you want to keep up, if you want to keep up and you want to be in the landscape that we are right now, you have to be looking and evaluating so that you're in the position to hit the refresh button at least once a year. I mean, for Cyber Media, we do quarterly audits of our brand. We do a social media audit of, you know, all of the people that are following us. We do a digital audit of our newsletter, old email addresses, people that might not be in the same position that they are. And we also do an audit of our existing customers to say, why are you working with us? Why have you been a client for 4 years? Like, why are you still here? And we use all of those words to do a comprehensive audit with the company. Yes.
I know that you mentioned that networking is important. And I just want to know, like, how do you successfully
Well, I think networking, there are a lot of components to successfully networking. There's an old tool that, you know, people like to use, I forget the author's name, that your network is your net worth. And people do believe it. And I will say, you know, I was able to build my company on the network of people that I knew. You know, it wasn't just happenstance that, you know, people call. It was maintaining and building relationships. And it goes back to one of the things that I said before. We live in a society where we have to give and take. And networking, you want to be able to give, and then take. You don't want everything to always be transactional. You want to always be in a position where you can be a resource for other people. So if you are, you know, in the position where you say, okay, I know my elevator pitch, I'm like working on the written component of my brand, I know that verbal point. When you are out there networking, you're essentially selling yourself. You're selling who you are, what you do, why you do it, how you do it, where you do it, because those people will remember. Our attention spans used to be 15 seconds. Now in the world of advertising, we say they're 1,000 thoughts a day. So if you are, if our brains are designed to have 65,000 thoughts a day, you can't possibly think that someone's going to retain all of the things that you're telling them. So it, with networking, it is essential to your success because you want at least one or two people in the room to always remember who you were, why you did it, where you did it, and how they can connect with you.
So I'm a realtor. I have obviously a presence online. I have a team now working for me. One of the young girls is a 22-year-old girl who vomits her emotional and personal business on social media. Unfortunately, now she's linked to me in all of my social media. So people are calling me saying, what's going on with your team? What's going on? Like, so damage control. They don't understand, you know, these young people especially don't understand what damage they're doing, not only to their own business, but other people's business. How do you deal with, you're talking about building a brand, but how do you damage control a brand that you've already created and is working for you?
Yeah.
And now
so,
all of a sudden it's damaged.
Yeah. What I left out was my first 3 years of cyber media was actually all crisis communications. So I've worked in the world of crisis communications, which is not fun because, you know, you like lifestyle, you get to build. But when you're in crisis mode, and it seems like you're in crisis mode, because that can essentially affect your bottom line. As a realtor, you have to trust this person. I want to like this person. I'm making a lifetime investment with this person. And if something is linked where it just doesn't match up to your brand, you want to distinguish that as quickly as possible. What you can do, because you're in crisis mode, so you'll have to sort of do two things at one time. You're definitely going to have to address that and let them know that this can financially impact the company. But you also want to set things up. Very early on in my career, I was hiring people because I liked them, not because they did a great job. And I found out that I was liking the wrong people. So I had to set up an internal communications plan. So, you know, I talked a lot about external facing, but internally, I had to say to people, here are, you know, here's the mission, the vision of Skyblue Media. Learn the commercial. When you walk into a room, I hired a media coach for the people that worked at my company because I learned that they were doing the like they didn't seem intelligent when they walked into a room. So I had to put all of these sort of steps into place to have an internal communications plan. And I said, here's why we always wear or utilize the color blue. You always have to wear a blue or always have to carry a blue pen or have something. But those were the rules and the guidelines. So instead of a regular employee handbook, we had an internal communications guide that gave everyone, again, our mission, our vision, our purpose. And we also gave people windows of opportunity. Here's how you bring us up in a conversation. And then we also gave, you know, don'ts. Like, here are the things that you just can't do. I had an employee once post a photo of himself in a Speedo bikini. And he thought that was perfectly fine. But I said, we had the largest technology company in the world as a client. If they Google, if they go to our website and say, I'm going to look up everybody at the company, and they see Alex in his Speedo bathing suit, what are they going to think about us? And we have young people as clients. So I had to say, if you do this, you don't belong here. And I gave an entire commercial to our set. I said, Skyblue Media is going to the 12th floor. Some of you will be pushed out on the third floor. Some of you will make it all the way to the fifth floor. And I might let you get all the way to the eighth floor. But on the 10th floor, I'm really going to evaluate who's going to ride those last two floors with me. And I think I'm going to have to hit the refresh button. I mean, these are uncomfortable conversations. And I had to tell people. And that one guy told everybody, I'm leaving Skyblue Media because Raheem is going to the 12th floor, and I'm getting off on the 10th. But for him, it was, if I can't do what I want to do, post photos in my Speedos, then I don't belong here. And if you give people a certain set of rules and regulations working with your company, your internal communications guide, that's how you pick and choose who you should be working with, who you should be surrounding yourself with. Mm-hmm. Yeah. How do I get people to take me seriously when I'm pitching them an idea? That's a great question, because all of my work is centered around pitching people ideas. I read a lot, and I come into the room with a lot of research, and I don't like to work on a hunch with anything. So if I think that I would like something, I'm going to say. So if I'm going to sell you an idea, I always put numbers, I always quantify things to say, you know, 80% of people purchase things when they look at color. Color is not just a thing that I like to talk about, but I go in and say, according to the last report that was published by Pantone Color Institute on it, September 7, 2017, they put out a statistic that 67% of people purchase color over anything else. And this is why you should take your brand seriously, and this is why you should be using the colors. So it's not just me working on a hunch and a whim, it's doing the necessary research and the fact checking before I get into it.
Sorry, you're so bright.
Oh, okay. Thank you.